Hi, today we'll talk about mathematics. We will generalize complex numbers and, in the process, come up with a neat alternate definition for imaginary numbers. We'll only connect this to physics right at the end of the video. Well, technically we'll only derive Gaussian integers in this video, which are complex numbers with integer values for the real and imaginary parts. We can extend this approach to include real numbers for these in a future video. I was introduced to imaginary numbers at school with the definition of I equals square root of negative 1, and I remember feeling uncomfortable with that. It's unintuitive because you have to take the mental leap to accept that the square root of negative 1 is an extra dimension orthogonal to the usual number line, which then opens the door to the immensely powerful complex numbers. This discomfort has historically held back the acceptance of imaginary numbers. You can even see that in the terms imaginary and real we still use today. It was Descartes who coined imaginary number as a derogatory term. The key to the eventual and reluctant adoption of imaginary numbers is that you absolutely need them for the solution to the cubic equations. We'll achieve three things in this video. First, we'll offer an alternative definition for imaginary numbers using loops and chains rather than square root of negative 1. Secondly, as a byproduct of this, we'll get a general set of numbers with arbitrary dimensions where the complex numbers are a subset. Thirdly, we'll define a nested hierarchy of dimensions. The complex numbers and Gaussian integers are great because they have dimensionality built in. Of course, you can do calculations with multidimensional vectors in mathematics. But to me, it doesn't feel like they generate dimensions because they presuppose unit vectors in the dimensions they use. Complex numbers, however, are intrinsically two-dimensional vectors. You can add them. You can multiply them with scalars to scale them. You can multiply them with I for a 90-degree rotation. You can multiply them with each other for a 2D rotation of arbitrary angles and scaling. We want to define an alternative to defining I as the square root of negative 1. You can define a complex number as an ordered pair, but to me that feels as contrived as the abstract vectors we mentioned earlier. Instead, we'll define I as the fourth root of positive 1, meaning that repeated multiplication of 1 with I takes 4 hops to make a loop, which makes I a fourth order rotational constant. We'll define one such constant per order. I'll call these rotational constants. The terms unity roots or roots of unity would also be fitting, but they're already used for complex numbers. The order 1 rotational constant is 1. Multiplying 1, or indeed any non-zero number with 1, goes on a one-hop journey to itself. The order 2 constant is negative 1. This creates a two-hop loop. Order 3 does not exist yet, so let's call that rotational constant j. With j we get natural 3D vectors. You can add them. You can multiply them with integers to scale them. You can multiply them with j to rotate their coordinates. But we won't define general multiplication between these 3D numbers. More about that later. So let's define this properly with a piano-like process. What is a number? It's just an abstract object that's only defined in relation to other numbers. The approach we'll use is reminiscent of graph theory. All the possible number objects in graph theory called vertices or nodes are each connected to all other objects through directed edges. Out of this big mess, we'll select one single special element at random, shown here in yellow. We'll also select directed edges that follow certain rules. So we need to nail down one object as an anchor. We'll define all the other number objects in relation to this. It doesn't matter which one we pick. So this is our first axiom, where we define zero. A unary function is a function with only a single argument. It takes a number object and transforms it into a new one. Traditionally, mathematicians use functions that have a defined domain and range. We call our functions open functions because they have an open domain. Any open function can be applied to any other object, and we can use their range to define new sets. So, for example, here we can also apply the function f to q. This way we can generate a set created by the function f. We'll pick the functions that are commutative. If we apply a sequence of functions in a different order, we'll still arrive at the same result. We denote repeated application of an open function to an object with a superscript. This is used as a shorthand notation, so instead of saying f of f, we can just say f to the 3. The functions are bijective and all have an inverse function, noted with a superscripted star here. In the diagrams, we'll show the inverse functions as dashed lines of the same color with the arrow pointing in the opposite direction. Bear the symmetry in mind though. Which arrows are solid and which are dashed is entirely a matter of definition. We define two types of these unary open functions, chains and loops. Chains keep generating new objects and never repeat. We call the open chain functions inc. Loops do as the name suggests. A loop of order n loops around in n steps. We call these rot. I can't see any other possible shapes than a chain or a loop arising from the repeated application of a function. Axiom 2. This says that two objects define the loop function between them. Here's an example. The red lines are not a valid loop of order 2 because the number objects they connect are already connected by the orange rot 4 function. This, however, is legal for a rot 2 function. Axiom 3. This axiom basically says that there's only one type of loop per order. It's so carefully worded because there are of course several ways to go around a loop. Even in our order 4 loop, we have two unary loop 2 functions, equivalent to times positive I and times negative I. We could swap positive I and negative I around if we wanted to. In general, for a prime order n, there are n minus 1 different ways around a loop. It's just a matter of definition which one we pick to denote the constant of that order. For example, here are the four valid loop 5 functions in a rot 5 loop. Axiom 4. This axiom states that order 2 is a special case because we use it to connect the rot and inc functions. Here we have an inc function starting from 0. The dotted line is the inverse. When we apply the dotted inverse function to 0, then we get another chain. We can associate every nth object on one chain with the nth object of the other chain, and we'll use the rot 2 function for that. This makes intuitive sense. If you take plus 1 as the inc chain, then the inverse is minus 1. So we use times negative 1 to map between them. Let's clean up this diagram a bit by removing the rot 2 loops and by only showing one of the inc chains. This whole process applies of course to all the possible inc chains. Here we just show one other one in navy blue. Axiom 5. Axiom 5 connects the rot and inc functions together. There are of course an unlimited number of different inc functions. We'll distinguish them with a subscript. Here we show the rot 4 loop in red. We only use two dimensions for convenience. Here's the whole thing in six dimensions. This defines the axes of a six-dimensional grid structure. The graphics becomes unwieldy and it looks like a spider's web, so back to two dimensions. Remove the loops for clarity. As we said, we can apply any function to any object. So with our commutativity rule, we finally arrive at the Gaussian integers in the plane. Now we have a general system of numbers with an arbitrary dimension. Let's call the set of numbers defined purely by loops of order n pure order. If n is odd, then the set is n-dimensional, and if n is even, the set is n over 2-dimensional. So the Gaussian integers are pure order 4. Because the order is even, it contains loop 2, which, due to axiom 4, does not create an extra dimension. In general, we know from axioms 3 and 4 that each non-prime order n contains the subloops of each of the divisors of n. But we want to call order 4 the set that also contains the preceding loops of order 1, 2, and 3. This comes out as pure order 12 because that's the least common multiple of 1, 2, 3, and 4. Let's build the first few orders in sequence to get a feel for the sets that are created. Order 1 is one-dimensional. Order 2 is still one-dimensional because of the special case of rod 2. The chain of number objects now goes in both directions. Order 3 is three-dimensional. P3 is the general form of such a three-dimensional number. Pure order 4 are the Gaussian integers in the plane. But the order 4 including the previously generated dimensions is now six-dimensional. This is the general form of an order 4 number, which you can look at as a 6D vector. This is a graphical tree representation that makes the hierarchy clear. You see here, orders 1 and 2 are one-dimensional. Order 3 contains 3 of these. And order 4 contains 2 subtrees of order 3. This is an order 3 tree, and here's the other one. In fact, you can rewrite P4 in terms of two three-dimensional vectors, U3 and V3. P4 written like this looks a bit like a Gaussian integer, except that the real and the imaginary coordinates are each 3D numbers themselves. Order 5 then contains 5 of these 6-dimensional numbers. Let's not write down the general form. Well, let's at least list the 30 dimensions. If we call the corresponding loop 5 constant h, then these are the dimensions. Order 6 is still 30-dimensional. The order 6 constant is negative j, which already exists, so we don't get any more dimensions. Order 7 is now 210-dimensional, because we get 7 of the 30-dimensional vectors. Order 8 contains 2 of these 210-dimensional vectors, so now we're at 420 dimensions. The order 8 constant squared is I, by the way. In summary, we now have a consistent axiomatic definition of a number system with arbitrary dimensions and integer parts that contain the Gaussian integers as a subset. We also have a hierarchical order that builds a particular hierarchy of dimensions. Mathematicians usually raise some objections to this, and I would like to address these here. Objection 1. You're reinventing the wheel. This is no big deal. The closest I've found to rotational numbers is an interesting approach in the book Complex Numbers in N Dimensions by Silvio Olariu. This offers several generalizations for some dimensions. The 3-dimensional case is exactly equivalent to our about 3 generated numbers. The book offers 4 different ways to arrive at 4 dimensions, one of which is equivalent to our pure order 8 numbers. The other 3 ways are disallowed by our system here because of axiom 3, which limits us to 1 loop per order. Many professional mathematicians prefer to think of this as a special case of a high-level concept, like a module over a ring. In my view, rotational numbers are not an advanced new concept at the cutting edge of mathematical research, but a fundamental number set that has been passed over in the drive towards abstraction. In my opinion, what should be taught in schools is the derivation of rotational numbers from loops and chains, followed by the special case of order 4, the complex numbers which are closed under multiplication and division. Objection 2. It is impossible that something so basic has been overlooked in maths. When you look at mathematical history, it's hard not to notice that. 1,500 years ago, zero was not considered a number. Even the ancient Greeks were not sure that zero was a number. Less than 500 years ago, negative numbers were called absurd and false numbers. 400 years ago, Descartes coined the term imaginary number as a derogatory term, as we mentioned before. 138 years ago, Cantor presented the hierarchy of infinities, and for this he was called a scientific charlatan and corrupter of youth. An even more recent example, although not a number set, is that the realization that we may have been using the wrong circle constant is less than 20 years old. So yes, there are precedents where the obvious was missed for hundreds of years. In a way, part of the motivation of this video is a bit similar to the Tao Manifesto, in the sense that it argues to introduce something well-known in perhaps a more logical way. Objection 3. These are just cyclotomic fields. The unity roots in cyclotomic fields are complex numbers and hence 2-dimensional. Our rotational constants actually create new dimensions orthogonal to each other and are not limited to the complex plane. However, they have many properties in common. For example, take a look at our order 12 loop here. There are 4 functions that generate an order 12 loop. Times ij, times negative ij, times ij squared, and times negative ij squared. This diagram is generated by times negative ij. This contains a number of subloops for the divisors of 12. Here are the loop 2 functions connecting the negatives, times negative 1. Here's one of the loop 3 functions, times j. And a loop 4 function, times I. Finally, a loop 6 function times negative j squared. All these subloops have already been explored in the context of cyclotomic fields. I think that the conventional insistence of all unity roots being complex numbers may stem from the desire to maintain multiplication for a closed set. Objection 4. But we need multiplication. If you really insist on this, you can define multiplication between rotational numbers using the usual distributive rules, but then you get cases where multiplying 2 non-zero numbers equals 0. Here's such an example. For algebras with commutative multiplication, it has been proven that they're none other than the complex numbers, or subsets of them, that are closed under division. This is a corollary of the fundamental theorem of algebra. We have disallowed multiplication in order to maintain permutability between the dimensions. Say we have a 3D vector x, y, z. If x is 1 and y and z are 0, then p is 1. If we swap x and y, then p is j. Multiplying with 1 and with j does something different, so the axes are not permutable. If you really want to define multiplication, I think you may have to add an extra axiom that defines the one object, and then you can connect this to the well-studied areas of fields and rings. Objection 5. Open functions are wrong. Functions need a domain and range. We need to separate what are mathematical traditions from natural and intrinsic rules, and I would argue that open functions are a very natural way to define sets. In the piano axioms, the successor function is used to generate numbers in the same way as our open functions. Objection 6. How about quaternions? The set of quaternions is one of the most famous extensions to complex numbers and one of the sets of the so-called hypercomplex numbers. Quaternions were discovered by Hamilton in 1843. These are four-dimensional numbers of this general form. Note that the J in quaternions is not the J we use for the ROT3 function. Quaternions maintain multiplication at the expense of commutativity. Quaternions are not a subset of rotational numbers because, as well as commutativity, they violate axiom 3, one loop per order. Quaternions are basically three separate complex planes that share the one direction. It was hoped that quaternions would be useful to describe fundamental physical processes with their dimensions representing three space and one time dimension, but that doesn't seem to have come about. Objection 7. What use is this J anyway? Here we get back to physics, as promised. Coordinates in a three-dimensional space can be represented using the order 3 numbers. As much as quaternions don't appear to feature in the algebraic design of nature, complex numbers undeniably do govern everything in electromagnetism. For example, the quantum theory that describes electromagnetism, QED, is expressed in terms of complex numbers. Its sister theory, QCD, which describes the strong force, needs to describe a threefold symmetry. Physicists have come up with the concept of color charge for that. QCD stands for quantum chromodynamics, while QED is quantum electrodynamics. Quarks come in one of three colors, red, green, or blue, with the antiquarks coming in the corresponding anti-colors, anti-red, anti-green, and anti-blue. Color is just a quirky name that has some analogy to the way that the human retina processes light. The fact is that while most other quark properties like spin and electric charge can be expressed as numbers, there was no suitable mathematical concept for such a threefold symmetry. It's my contention that negative J is a better term than anti-green. To me, it looks like there's a deep connection between the order 3 numbers and the nuclear strong force, and between the order 4 numbers and electromagnetism. In the next video, we'll start to connect the rotational numbers to physics. Thanks for watching.